My name is Rose Amador LeBeau. I am president and CEO of CTC. Our mission is to help people through employment and education become self-sufficient. We have a day worker center. We have educational programs so people can get their GEDs. We serve a variety of people, people who've just become unemployed, people who have never worked. We work with homeless people. We work with people who have just gotten out of prison and have to re-enter the workforce. So we're full service. I think it's seeing people make the change, become successful, make that transition, and actually having an impact on people's lives, a positive impact. To see these success stories is what it's all about. Good afternoon. I'm Siwabili Rose Amador, and this is Native Voice TV. Welcome to the show. You know, we've been hearing so much about Standing Rock lately, and here in our community, Santa Clara County, San Jose, we have been standing with Standing Rock. And this show will focus on some of the things that have gone on in our community. For one, our County Board of Supervisors took a stand to support Standing Rock. Our San Jose City Council also took that stand to support Standing Rock. We've had fundraisers in our community. We raised about, well, I want to say about $4,500. We bought a lot of supplies, and people from the community here, the Native community, Native Voice TV went out. Our producer, Steve Macias, went out to Standing Rock, and they took a lot of supplies that are desperately needed out there. And so we'll be showing you footage from Standing Rock, a rally we had here in San Jose. And I have a special guest with me, Assemblyman Ash Kara. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
And congratulations on your election.
I appreciate it.
And, you know, Ash actually went out to Standing Rock, and you took some supplies out to Standing Rock, and you have a bill. So first, tell me about your experience going to Standing Rock.
Well, you know, I went a week after my election. And so the week after, you know, November 13th or so, I went out there. And I wanted to go to Standing Rock during the course of the election, and I was going to go win or lose, you know, because it wasn't about me. It was about me going there to see what I could do to help, and also to experience what was happening there, because there's definitely something special happening at Standing Rock. And so me and three of my friends raised about $2,000. We went out to Standing Rock. We used that money to buy supplies they needed at that moment in time. We were there for about 3 days. We spent the night there, and spent a couple days helping with the construction.
And you were there before the snow, right? The big snowfall?
In fact, I was there. We were there literally the week before Thanksgiving.
Okay.
And so the Thursday before Thanksgiving, as we were sitting around the campfire, a snow flurry came in. That was the first snow since the camp has started, but it wasn't a big snow. So it was actually the next week during Thanksgiving weekend.
Okay.
That's when the first storm hit. And so when we were there, what they were doing is they were winterizing. They were preparing for the snow. And so I made three runs with my friends into Bismarck, about an hour away. And we would buy, you know, power saws, circular saws, and, you know, hammers, nails, everything they needed at that moment in time to help winterize, which they're building these wooden boards to put under the tents and the yurts and the teepees to get everything off the ground, because the ground is ice cold. And so just lifting it off the ground by itself has a dramatic impact on the warmth inside those tents. And so, you know, there were thousands of people there. So they were really furiously building these floors for the different types of housing that people had out there.
So what was your experience arriving there? Who were you greeted with? Was there security? What was that experience like? And how were you treated?
When we got there, you know, we got there early in the morning. We went and I had rented a pickup truck. We filled it full of firewood and drove down there. And we first went to the smaller camp, the Sacred Stone Camp, I believe it's called. It's a smaller one. We went there first, gave them most of our wood, and then went to the larger camp. And everywhere we went, people were very warm. They're welcoming. They want you to be there. There aren't, there's no sense that, you know, we don't want you here. They're not a questioning, but rather they want you in there. There are definitely rules, but there's also a sense of freedom there where you, you can find your own place to put your tent up, find your own, you know, you kind of have to be self-sufficient. You got to make sure you bring your own food, bring your own supplies. You're not taking from the camp to the best extent you can. Of course, people are very warm and welcoming and they'll give you what they have. But when we went there with our own supplies, we bought a four-person tent with four cots and four, you know, winter sleeping bags, knowing that we were only going to use them for a couple of days and then we just don't need them. Yeah, and but everyone was extremely warm. You, when you get there, it's you have to find something to do. And that's what I loved about it is that you can walk anywhere and find something to do, but you can't just go there. It's not a vacation. It's, you're not going there just to say, oh, it's cool to be here. You know, there are no names or titles. No one knew who I was. I went there to help. And we did. We went to the construction area, and a couple of my friends went to the medic area, helped to build, you know, build a teepee there, and me and another friend were help carrying supplies. I'm not the handiest, so it's better for me to actually assist those that know what they're doing with the hammer and with the wrenches and all that. And so I was there to help, carrying the wood, holding things in place. Like I said, taking supply runs. We went to the
area. Is that the closest store or big city?
Yeah, it's about an hour away to get to any hardware store that had supplies. And so we would go there and get an inventory of what they wanted and go drive, pick up more firewood, and come back. So it'd be about a three-hour run all together, and we'd come back. And you know, but they loved it because I think sometimes people are shipping things in or sending things in, but at that moment in time, their needs might be different. And so they loved the fact that hey, they asked for a circular saw and a power drill and all that, and you know, 3 hours later, here it is. And so it was great for those. They had very skilled people, by the way, that were running the construction area and all that. Tradesmen, there is a whole union in the camp, the large camp itself, there are smaller camps. There was a union camp of folks there that were there to help. And we were there about a week and a half before, about 2 weeks before the veterans came.
Right,
heard about the veterans coming and all that. So it was beautiful to see everyone from around the world coming there. We met people from outside the country there. And there were over 200 flags of different tribes, many of whom.
I've seen so many of those pictures. It's just amazing. I think Steve's probably going to show some of those as well because he took a lot of footage there. Of course, you'll see that in the footage that they arrived after the snow or right after the big snowstorm hit. So they had, it was pretty cold when they were there.
I mean, it was bitter cold before the snow came. So I can't imagine because these are flatlands. So the bitter wind that comes in, there are no mountains or buildings to block it. And so we parked our vehicle, we had a pickup truck we rented, we parked it and put our tents right behind it to try to block some of the wind. And a lot of people did that. So we were learning some of the tricks that people were doing as they'd been there for a while. I mean, some people had been there for months.
Right.
But there were some people that were coming for a couple of days, some for a week, some for 2 weeks. No matter how long you were there for, you were appreciated. And said, you know, thank you for being here. Thank you for spending a day with us. You know, and so it's definitely a loving community. And there's a sense that, you know, that working together, that we can survive. It was a great sense of a communal atmosphere, a great sense of being connected to the land. And I really felt the love just being there. And I wanted to be there so that I can take that with me in the next chapter and next journey of my life. Like I said, I was going whether I won or lost. So my journey of service is a lifelong journey. And it's those moments that that remind you why you're doing it.
I know people that went were saying they felt like they were like, this is the way it must have been a long time ago, you know, peaceful, everybody helping each other and, you know, intense and, you know, out in the, the open.
And smart. I mean, the you have to really be creative on how you use your resources. And so some of the some of the things that are being done, some of the tricks of the trade, I mean, these are things that have been passed down for generations. And to be able to see it being done just kind of matter-of-factly, you know, these are tribes that know what they're doing. And you put some of us city folks out there, we'd be lost, right? It's like we'd be totally lost. And so it's amazing to see how the foundation of our civilization, of our community, of our nation was built upon the skills and knowledge of these tribes, and certainly there, the not just the Standing Rock Sioux tribe, but so many other tribes, that were involved there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. In fact, I met a woman that was that was seemingly in charge, at least, you know, of this one of the blessings in the morning, and she was from Oakland.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, she was part of a tribe. She's from Oakland, so it was. I met a lot of California folks out there. It was awesome to see that.
Yeah, it seems like almost everybody we know went out at some point.
Yeah.
So it's just fantastic. We're planning on going in March, and hopefully everything is still.
Well, it's a troublesome time because now, with the new administration, you really do worry about the violence. And we saw out there the violence that has already been perpetrated against the peaceful protesters and water protectors. Now, with this administration, you really worry the level to which they're going to take that militaristic force. And so now more than ever, we need to be protecting the water protectors and showing them our support, either by being there physically, sending resources, letting our elected officials know that we stand with them.
Right, right. And I'm so glad they do. I'm so glad they do it in our county, in our city.
Absolutely.
It's so helpful. When our crew went out there, they took a lot of propane, because of the weather conditions, coats, gloves, all kinds of cold weather, items.
Yeah.
And I'm sure they're probably still in need of all those items because it is still so cold out there. And I know some of the footage that Steve sent us, and I'm sure that he'll be showing, is they were just in a blizzard, literally in a blizzard. You could barely see them because of the wind and the snow and so forth. But
I was born in Canada. I lived there until I was 6 years old. That kind of cold, you feel it all the way in your bones. I mean, you feel it all the way through your body. There's no escaping it. You can put jackets on that. So having the fires and the propane and the protected tents and teepees and yurts and all that is critical.
Right.
Because people will die, I mean, otherwise, if you don't have that.
Absolutely. Now tell me, now you've been in the assembly, a month? But you already have a couple bills.
Yeah.
But tell us about the one that would affect Standing Rock and funds going to the pipeline.
As soon as I got sworn into office, I put forward a bill proposal, AB 20. What AB 20 asks or does is it divests our state pension funds, which are enormous. It divests them from the company building the Dakota Access Pipeline. And the reason why I put it forward is numerous. One is that if we're gonna talk about being this leader in climate change as Californians and focusing on renewable energy, we have to put our money where our mouth is.
That's
and that
right.
means removing money from fossil fuels and the pollution that's being created by what I like to call 19th century dirty fossil fuel technology. We have to focus on 21st century forward-thinking investments, forward-thinking technology that's going to protect the Earth for future generations. The other aspect of it is to protect Native American sovereignty.
Mm-hmm.
The Standing Rock Tribe, and you can go online and listen to this. They have an audio recording of this from over 2 years ago of the Chairman Archambault and the Tribal Council over 2 years ago telling representatives from the Army Corps of Engineers that, look, we oppose this pipeline. And we don't want it anywhere near our land. So once again, we have hundreds of years of history of the European settlers and then the United States of America as a nation breaking treaties left and right.
That's right.
We need to learn from history and respect Native American sovereignty. So that's another really important component of why I put the bill forward.
Thank you so much for doing so. I know it'll be a struggle, but we're in the struggle for the long haul.
Well, if anyone knows struggles, it's our indigenous communities.
Absolutely.
They've been in the struggle for hundreds of years. And so I'm honored to to play a small part in joining in this struggle, in standing with the water protectors and with Standing Rock.
Thank you. Thank you for going out there and taking supplies.
Amazing.
And thank you for your bill and all your support.
Thank you.
So, Mini Wichonni.
Yes, water is life, of course.
Water is life. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next week on Native Voice TV. Good night.
Hello, my name is Joey Torres, and we are here in North Dakota at Standing Rock Reservation, and I'm here with Victor. And tell me a little bit about what's going on.
How me talk you be Leon Petuki lay yuski on Chantewa stay no pet yusapolo. Tatanka ia me na o yuchpe awati o glala lakota hemielo. I want to introduce myself. My name is Victorio Camp, half Ponca and half Oglala. I grew up in I'm an enrolled member of the Oglala Lakota tribe in South Dakota. On my father's side, I'm also Ponca. My father's name was Carter Camp. He's a founder of the American Indian Movement and war chief at Wounded Knee. My mother's name is Michelle Richard. On my mother's side, I come from the Red Cloud Teochpa'i, Makhpia Luta Teochpa'i on the Pine Ridge Reservation. That's where I was born and raised. And today, where we sit is Ochete Shakonwi Camp. It's a camp of water protectors made up of many different nations. There's close to maybe 500 nations that are camped together to protect the sacred water. And we don't call ourselves protesters. We're not here protesting anything. We're here to protect our treaty territory. We're here to protect our sacred sites. And also, most importantly, we're here to protect the sacred water. Back in April, there was one veteran, his name was American Horse, and a group of youth came to Sacred Stone Camp, and they wanted to protect the water because they heard that the pipeline was going to be coming right through here. So the youth decided to have a run to Washington, D.C. to bring awareness about this, and so the youth were the ones who brought the spark to the people. And there was a lot of different, I don't know how to say it, but there was a lot of the different people who brought us here. But yeah, the youth were the first to run for awareness. So I always give the youth credit for bringing us here, you know. And I guess I could say it was the youth. I was at Sundance at home, and when I got done Sundancing and I went up and seen what's going on in the real world after 4 days after, and I saw them on I think it was the internet, social network, you know, and they said the youth run to Washington to stop the pipeline from crossing the river, and I had all this information. And so I said, you know what, I'm going up there. I said, that's our treaty territory, and the youth are calling us to come up there. And they put a call out. They asked all warriors, all Lakota warriors, to come and protect the land. And when that call went out, we knew it was time to go. We already understood the power of the river, the life that the river gives. We understood the sacred ground right here that we're camped on. We know the sacred place, and so we wanted to come stop this desecration and this black snake, you know. The Dakota Access Pipeline is funded by 17 major banks in America. Okay. Wells Fargo, Citibank, all the major banks in America are behind this. And also foreign countries are behind it also. They have funders in foreign countries such as Canada and China.
That's where it's coming from, right? It's Canada?
No, it's coming from the bacon fields right up here in North Dakota. Yeah, right now is where it's coming from. But they want to eventually link it to the tar sands.
The tar sands, okay.
In Canada, because you know, before this, we stopped the KXL pipeline.
Yes.
We fought for a few years doing the same kind of stuff we are here to stop this pipeline. So because of that struggle, we already knew a lot of tactics and how to fight this pipeline, you know. That was a really long, hard fight for my family also, because we took the lead on that fight too. So, and you know, we started moccasins on the ground to protect Mother Earth back then, and we trained hundreds and hundreds of activists all throughout the nation, from Montana to Oklahoma. We traveled all over and brought that awareness to the Keystone XL pipeline, and we're lucky enough to stop it, you know. The Dakota Access Pipeline is coming through treaty territory and trying to cross the Missouri River, which is the place where all Lakota tribes in South Dakota and North Dakota get their water. So we're here to protect the water. We're here to protect the sacred sites against this pipeline. The Dakota Access Pipeline has tried to come through without consulting the tribes. And trying to come through without consulting us on our own treaty territory. The Dakota Access Pipeline hired mercenary security guards to protect their workers from the people, from a non-violent people. You know, we come here in a prayerful way, a beautiful way to protect our land. It's, we have every right to assemble here on our treaty territory. And right now, over the last few months, we've been going out on the land to protect the water, using our bodies, putting ourselves in front of the workers, I guess, in front of the machines. There's been people who tied themselves to machines to stop the workers, and we've been attacked many times with rubber bullets. We've been attacked with tear gas and mace. And one of the worst attacks is when the DAPL security used dogs on our people. And that was really a sad day for our people, but we ended up chasing them off that day, and we chased them off our land. And at that time, we created a north camp here right in front of the path of the pipeline, and we reclaimed that as a treaty territory. So it was reclaimed land that we had our northern camp on, and we had that camp up for almost 3 months up there. Okay. And whenever so we established camp, everything was real good until the governor of North Dakota decided to bring the police and the military police into
National Guard?
The National Guard and the police. They brought in police from all over North Dakota, South Dakota, Montana, Minnesota, Wyoming. Many different police came, I guess, the different agencies. There's multiple agencies here from all over right now. And so the day that the government stepped in and decided to protect DAPL was a hard day for the people. From that time on, there's been violence against us. Many people been tear gassed, many people been shot with rubber bullets, concussion grenades. They call them these little grenades that rubber balls shoot out of. We've been shot with those, you know. A young lady has her arm hit with a concussion grenade, and it blew her arm almost clear off. Another Indian lady here who's in Minnesota now going to surgery on her eye, they shot a tear gas canister and it hit her in the eye. And so she's trying not to lose her left eye. You know, there was young men here shot off his horse when they were pushing us back, and they shot his horse also. He had to go and get, you know, I can't remember the amount of stitches in his head, staples in his head, because he was shot in the head. Down by the river where our sacred mountain is there, there's a sacred hill across the river that we've been protecting for months. And all of a sudden, the military police came in there one night and set up with their, you know, weapons and huge lights and razor wire, and the warriors were in the water and the police were on the other side, and we were trying to get across to protect our mountain, and I mean our sacred hill, and many people were shot that day. And you might have heard of it, but there was even, I don't know what news place she worked for, CNN or something, and she happened to come with a guy named John Fox, he's a documentary dude, but this cop shot at this young warrior and it happened to miss and hit the water with the rubber bullet. Mm-hmm. And the water bounced it up and it hit the reporter that day.
Oh, wow.
And that made national news. But what didn't make the news is that same day, a 17-year-old Lakota warrior got shot in the face. Mm-hmm. And these are the things that people don't talk about, or I guess the public don't know about. Yeah. The violence that's being used. Just the other day, before the snow hit, we were over at the mountain praying, and they were on the loudspeaker threatening to shoot us if we didn't move, and they did shoot some rounds of rubber bullets beside the people down there. they took our canoes. They took our canoes and put holes in them and put razor wire around them. So if you go down there right now, you can see all our canoes laying there. And they destroyed our own personal property. A lot of those canoes, the people were using them to fish on the river here to feed the people.
It dumbfounds me how our law enforcement, our government, can't not do anything but protect the pipeline. And how would you feel if I came into your backyard and start destroying things, affecting things, taking things away from you, hurting your family? What would you do? You're going to stand up and fight for them, right? Or call the police? Huh. The police are my friends. We're going to take shit from your home. We're going to hurt your family. Oh, we're going to call your bosses, the government. Nah, those are my friends too. That's how we feel.
Yeah.
There's no recourse. What do we do? You know, try to get people's attention. We're here. Somebody help us, you know. We're not just standing up here. Honestly, do you think half of us would be here? Freezing weather, in the snow, in the rain, in 100 degree temperature, just for the fun of it, because we had no place to go. There's no purpose in what we're doing. I hope that you're down. Are you back down to save your family? Are you back down to protect what's yours? No matter how much money you were king. Did you give us the right to protect your family, protect your home, protect what God gave you?
Hi, my name is Peely, and I am going to read you my poem called My Voice is Small. My voice is small, yet I will be as loud as a drum. I will scream from the mountain high, yet gentle and delicate as the feather of our people. With peace on my lips and dreams in my heart, you will not take our land apart. Water that is sacred, water that is life, water that purifies, for you now we will battle and strive. I stand with Standing Rock, firm, strong, united. I soar with the Standing Rock. My spirit and land will not be divided. My voice is small, yet with it I will fight. Listen to me, hear my courage, on my knees with Mother Earth. Give us strength to understand how we protect our sacred land.